Recorded Books and RB Digital present Shattered Roads by Alice Henderson. Narrated by Emily Pike Stewart. Chapter 1. Ben had barricaded the door and been as quiet as possible, but now they'd come for him. He could hear them pounding on the door. He scrambled out of his hole beneath the floorboards. He'd found tunnels down there. Rooms. Maybe there was a way out, a tunnel he could escape through. But he wasn't sure, and he could die down there if he got trapped. He just couldn't stake his life on it. He hadn't had enough time to explore. He knew they wouldn't find the hole. They wouldn't know to look for it, and wouldn't waste the time anyway. He spent precious seconds heaving himself up through the hole and then replacing the floorboards. As he threw the rug in place, the strange beeping emanating from those parts below stopped. It had started a few days ago, coming from somewhere under the building in that dark catacomb of rooms. He'd never found the source. And now, the repurposers were here. He shouldn't have unplugged from the network. He knew that now, but he had had to unplug because of the chatter. How could he listen to the mysterious beeping over all that chatter? He'd never noticed it before, the constant talking. But suddenly, when he tried to concentrate on that strange alarm coming from below, he realized he couldn't hear anything but the monotonous drone of meaningless voices. What handbag was the star of high-rise living carrying in last night's episode? Win 80,000 creds by playing the beta version of Maximum Shopping. Get a new look for your avatar. They must have immediately noticed his absence from the network and sent the men. He had to get out of there. He ran to the barricaded front door, ready to throw the furniture aside. When he peered through the peephole, he saw men waiting in the hallway. They'd covered this escape route. There was no other way out of his apartment. No windows that worked. No back doors. Just the front door and the tunnels beneath, which as far as he'd explored had not led out. A deafening buzz erupted on a wall he shared with his neighbor. They were cutting through. He had to get out of there. He grabbed a chair, ran up next to the wall. As the plaster caved in, he waited until a head appeared. He brought the chair down, hard. The man crumpled, but another took his place, and Ben struck him, too. He grabbed the second man, pulling him through the hole, then dove through the opening into his neighbor's living pod. He'd never seen the neighbor in person before, though he'd lived next to him his whole life. There he was, sitting on his couch, eyes fixed on his display, hands flying over the virtual keyboard. The man didn't even turn. Ben ran. He threw open his neighbor's front door and dashed into the hallway, smashing into one of the repurposers waiting there. Then he bolted in the opposite direction, not knowing where to go. He'd only been out in the hallway once before, when they first installed him in his living pod. He had to make it to the street that he'd seen so many times from his window. Maybe someone could help him. He banged on doors as he ran, shouting for help. No one came out. No one even stuck a head out to look at him. Even though he knew the building was filled to capacity, it felt dead inside. At the end of the hall, he saw a door. He burst through it, and sudden heat struck him in the face. He stared around, not sure which way to go. He bolted left at random. He sucked in the torrid air, happy just to be outside. He'd only been outside once before, the day he came here all those years ago. Back then, it had been freezing. The streets lay empty. No one walked around. He could hear noises from the living pod buildings all around him, huge structures that reached into the amber sky. Light and sound emanated through the windows, coming from thousands of displays and entertainment channels. He shouted again for help, then thought better of it. No one was even coming to the windows to look, and shouting only gave away his location. For someone to help, they'd have to detach from the network. That's what he had done. And now, they would make him pay for it. He spotted a shadowed place next to a building and ran to it. Pressed into the dark, he heard the whirring of some kind of machinery coming from inside. The wall felt hot, hotter than the sticky air. He caught his breath, then dared a look around for the men who followed him. As his eyes adjusted to the shadows, he saw an old metal door in the wall. He ran to it and yanked on the handle. An even hotter blast of air hit him, along with a dazzling light. Squinting, he stepped inside, closing the door behind him. Raising his hand, he shielded his eyes against the glare of overhead lights. He stood on a steel platform with stairs leading down. Below him stretched a hive of activity. White steam billowed in the air, and the whir and groan of machinery almost deafened him. Dozens of people milled around long tables, some folding laundry, some preparing food cubes. One man sat at a bench repairing a food delivery drone. The people weren't using displays. They didn't have keyboards. They weren't plugged in. He glanced this way and that. No sign of the men who'd come after him. He ran down the stairs toward the man fixing the drone. The man looked up as Ben reached him. "Can you help me?" Ben asked, trying to catch his breath again. "What's wrong?" The man put down his tools. "Men are after me."
"After you?"
The man's brow furrowed.
"What do you mean?"
"They mean to repurpose me." The repairman stared at him, noticing the network jack in the side of his head.
"You're from the living pods?"
he asked, looking amazed.
"Yes." "And you aren't plugged in?"
Ben glanced at the others. They took no notice, just continued their work.
"I thought you couldn't live without being plugged in."
"What do you mean?"
"That's when the corpse cleaners come. When someone has unplugged from the network."
Ben shook his head. His mouth had gone dry.
"You die without it."
He backed away. "I don't think it works like that." He'd been unplugged for days now, and he was fine.
"The men will come and plug you back in,"
the repairman assured him. Ben turned. He had to get out of there. He ran back toward the stairs, but just then, the door banged open. The three men from his living pod stood on the platform, pinpointing him on the busy warehouse floor. He pivoted and ran the other way, but not before two more men entered through a different door. Closing in from all sides, they homed in on him. Panic swelled up inside him. He made a dash toward all the people folding laundry and making food. He sped through them, his pursuers close behind. Then one of the repurposers tackled him, sending him sprawling across the floor. In an instant, the rest fell on him, grabbing Ben's hands, wrists, and legs. He thrashed, crying out for help. The workers stared down at him, and one advanced, but the repurposer waved her off.
"No need," he told her. "He unplugged from the network and is going a little crazy. We need to take him back to his pod and reconnect him."
She nodded and went back to folding laundry.
"No!"
Ben shouted. He kicked his legs, but still they carried him toward the metal door. They lifted him up the stairs and dragged him outside. As he thrashed in horror, they retraced his footsteps, hauling him back to his building, down the hallway toward his living pod, in through his neighbor's place, and through the hole.
"It's not killing me to be disconnected. You've got it wrong," he screamed.
The men remained stoic. They pulled him into his bathroom. He thrashed, knocking over his supply cabinet, spilling towels into the shower. A vase fell off the sink and shattered. Still, they held him tightly. None of them made eye contact. He wasn't a person, just a thing.
"Hold him down," one said. They flipped him onto his stomach, and one knelt on his back.
He felt the man's gloved hand on his head, pressing down, parting his hair over the network jack in his skull. The man brought out a gleaming metal instrument with a circular saw on one end.
Ben kicked out on the cold tile, but the others held down his arms and legs.
The man brought the tool up to his head jack, and Ben felt a blistering pain in his head.
Everything went gray, then black and white. All their voices became muffled.
"The jack is corrupted," he heard the man say. "I don't think we'll be able to repurpose him. There's dust in here, some weird debris. What has this guy been up to?"
He felt the men readjust their weight on him.
"I'll give it a try."
He brought the tool in again, and a searing flash of heat erupted inside Ben's head. He flailed, fought against them, but all he could smell was burning flesh. Suddenly, a white-hot eruption filled his eyes, and his brain felt too big for his skull. He screamed as it swelled, his teeth cracking against the tile. He squeezed his eyes shut. An agonizing pain racked his body. His legs skittered on the floor. His fingers opened and closed. His eyes fluttered and he couldn't breathe. Blood leaked out of his eyes, drowning out his vision. Then the black came, seeping over him, filling up all the cracks in his view. His body went slack.
"We're losing him," one of the men commented.
"Looks that way," said the one with the tool.
Air rushed out of Ben's lungs as the black took over his mind. Chapter 2. H124 waited outside the door, closing her eyes and concentrating on the theta wave receiver by the door lock. She mentally sent the message, "Unlock," and the door hissed open. Quietly, she stepped inside with her gear, then stopped as she heard noise coming from the main room. Someone still lived in this pod. Her employers had told her that the only way to access the corpse was through the neighboring pod. Weird, but she didn't ask questions. Maybe the deceased's lock was broken. Still, she'd never been inside someone's place while they still occupied it, and she felt uncomfortable. A stranger in someone's home. She crept into the main room. Her instructions told her they'd created a hole in the wall there. A light flickered on the wall as she moved forward. Not wanting to disturb the occupant, she stepped lightly in her work boots. She knew she'd get in trouble if she interrupted him. She stepped around the corner and saw him, seated before his display, his button pad shimmering in midair just below his hands. The light from his display hovered in the air before him. She knew about these display setups and button pads that most people were equipped with, but she'd only been in these living pods to clean out the previous tenants after they'd passed on, so she'd never seen the equipment turned on before. Just ahead, she could see the ragged, dark hole in the wall. But her eyes returned to the floating display. She'd never seen anything so beautiful. She knew she wasn't supposed to, but she stopped before stepping through the hole. Unable to help herself, she stared at the display. 6 windows filled the screen, and the man's eyes darted from one to the other. Both hands fluttered over the button pad, fingers pressing down in such a rapid sequence, she didn't know how he could possibly make sense of what he was doing. In one window, he controlled an image of a little man who moved through different rooms of a building, pulling levers and pressing buttons on walls. In another flashed a sequence of unintelligible numbers. Another window held an animated avatar of someone else, a woman, with text flying across the screen just beneath her face. Every few seconds, his hands would stream over the buttons and more text would fly by. A group of people talked in yet another window, sitting around a table chattering about someone named Phil and how they couldn't believe that he had opted for the small swimming pool when he could have had the bigger one. Along the bottom of the screen scrolled more text. "This year's most important decision. Pick the right candidate. Vote wisely. watch the candidates' videos. Yes, vote for your favorite reality TV star in this all-important election to determine which show will be renewed. In yet another window, a little graph fluctuated up and down, beeping out sounds every now and then. Whenever it beeped, the man entered text in the window, pressing some more buttons until it stopped beeping. His eyes never left the display, and his fingers never stopped working at the keypad. It fascinated her that he could attend to so many things at once. What was he even doing in each of the windows? She had no idea. He stood up suddenly, and she leaped back into the shadows. He walked to his wall slot as a delivery drone clattered in the vent and came through. The display followed in front of the man while his fingers kept typing away. The drone hovered briefly, laid down the man's new food tray with the food cubes, then took away his empty tray from earlier that day. It buzzed and vanished back into the vents. Rapidly, the man reached out, grabbed the squares, and shoved them into his mouth. Then he returned to his seat, his attention on the display not once faltering. Her face burning, H124 realized she'd been standing there far too long. If her employers found out, she'd be ticketed. Or worse, they could assign her even more extra duties. She was lucky the man hadn't noticed her. She stepped forward quietly and reached the hole in the wall. Without a sound, she stepped through it into the dead man's apartment. She could smell the corpse before she saw it. She wondered why they'd waited so long to call her on site. She followed the sickly, sweet smell down a dark corridor to the bathroom. He lay sprawled on the bathroom floor, legs twisted at an odd angle. His bloody head lay in a pool of crusted red on the white tile. She crept closer, staring down at him. She'd never seen a death like this before. She'd seen heart attacks, disease, a broken neck once. But this was different. Violent. She didn't see how he could have done this to himself, even if he'd slipped and fallen on the tile, cracking his head open. She bent closer, looking at his skull. It wasn't a fracture he'd bled from. It was an evenly cut hole in his skull. She'd heard that if jacked-in citizens unplugged from the network, they risked death. Is this what happened? Had the man's cranial implant malfunctioned? She slung her tool bag off her shoulder, placing it on the floor. The coppery scent of blood hung strongly in the bathroom, lingering above the fetid smell of decay. She tried to breathe through her mouth and pulled out a thick plastic body bag from her supplies. Kneeling over the body, she rolled him onto his back. She tugged on his shirt, and his face came free from the dried pool of blood. He was heavy, tall, and flabby, probably around 35 or so. She unzipped the bag and moved it along the floor until it lay flush to him. She sat back on her heels, preparing to roll him into it. Grabbing his arm, she stopped. A sound echoed up from beneath her. A beeping sound. She paused, listening. It was muffled, like it wasn't coming from this unit. Cautiously, she stood up and walked back into the hall. Craning her neck, she tried to pinpoint the sound. She moved back toward the hole in the wall, thinking it might be coming from the next living pod, but it wasn't. She walked back toward the bathroom. The beeping grew louder. She walked past the bathroom toward the man's bedroom. She stopped at the end of the hallway, just before its doorway. The sound was loudest here, an incessant, unfamiliar beeping. She knelt down, and it stopped. She waited, but after minutes of silence, she stood up and returned to the bathroom. Stooping down, she rolled the body into the bag. She began zipping it up and looked back at the man's head. The wound was circular and clean, right where his implant should have been. Curious, she leaned closer, staring at the hole. The man's implant hadn't malfunctioned. It was completely gone, and something had seared his brain tissue. She stared down at the blackened flesh, wrinkling her nose at the acrid smell that wafted up. She looked around the bathroom, seeing a shattered vase, a group of towels spilling out of the hutch above the toilet. Her gut roiled around inside her. Something wasn't right. This wasn't a natural death or an accident. His brain had been destroyed violently. He had struggled, fought against someone. Who had removed his implant? And where was it now? Who would have had access to his pod? Only her employers, or a worker like herself. Maybe someone had tried to save him when his implant shorted out. She didn't like it, and she grew nervous, wanting to finish the job. She finished zipping him up inside the thick plastic, then tugged him out into the hallway. Straightening up, she looked back into the bathroom. Blood had pooled under him, crusted and dried. She pulled out the bleach and scrub brush and went to work. When a new person was installed in this living pod, it had to look spotless. She scrubbed and wiped until the white tile floor gleamed. Then she went through the whole pod, righting an upended lamp in the hallway. Housekeeping would take care of the rest, resupplying the bathroom with new linens and other necessities. She returned to the body bag. He was heavy. She'd have to drag him out with the harness. She pulled it out of her bag and stepped into it. Tightening it around her chest, she was glad he lived near the corner of the building. Even so, it would take a lot of effort to get him down the exterior hallway to the incinerator. She pulled out the tow ropes and attached them to the body bag with carabiners. She was about to attach him to her harness when the beeping started again. She stood silently in the darkened hallway, listening. She waited for it to stop, but it didn't this time. Dropping the ropes, she walked to the end of the hallway where it was loudest. A red and black carpet covered the floor there. The sound was coming from underneath. She was sure of it. She knew the utility tunnels well, having been navigating them since she was 4. They didn't run under this part of the building. It should be just dirt under there. She peeled the carpet back and stared at the floorboards. Faint scratches marred their plastic edges. While all the planks still lay flush together, she noticed their nails had been removed. As she bent lower, she found a broken fingernail. She leaned back on her heels, stood up. On a thought, she returned to the body bag and unzipped it. Pulling out the man's cold arm, she found all of his fingernails bloody and torn. He'd been scratching at the floor. The beeping continued, insistent, demanding. What was it? Then, just as suddenly as it started, it came to an end. She waited, but it didn't resume. Taking a knee, she traced her fingers along one of the boards. At the end, she tugged upward, and it came free, revealing a support beam beneath. Under it lay darkness. She lifted up a few more boards, laying them quietly to one side. Glancing back toward the hole in the wall, she made out the faint glow from the man's display in the next pod. He had taken no notice of her. She felt exposed, crouching there, exploring, not doing her job. Her heart hammered, and her mouth went dry at the thought of him peeking through the hole, or, worse, her employers showing up for an inspection. But no one came through the ragged hole in the wall. She grabbed her headlamp and her tool bag and returned to the opening in the floor. Donning the light, she switched it on and pointed it down into the darkness. The beam traveled over rubble from an ancient ceiling. More support beams and strange shapes clustered in shadow. It was a whole other room, she realized. A room beneath this one. Her nose wrinkled as a moldy odor stirred upward. She swung her legs over into the darkness. Sitting on the edge, she hovered between two worlds. What lay beneath this living pod? She always thought it had been built on the ground floor. Before she even knew she'd made the decision, she gripped the edge of the floor with her hands and lowered her legs down into the unknown. Chapter 3. H-124's feet thrashed inside the hole until they found a stable spot on the rubble. Slowly, she lowered her full weight onto it. With only her head above the floor of the deceased man's living pod, she glanced one more time toward the hole at the end of the hallway. Nothing had changed. She turned away, aiming her light down into the black. The rubble angled downward, so she slid and stumbled her way to the base of the pile, reaching a sloping floor. Dust motes hung in the air, and a thick blanket of gray covered strange rectangular shapes around the room. Stopping to listen for any sounds above, she stared up through the hole. Then she turned, playing her light over the shapes. A large desk stood against one wall, with a chair in front of it. Two items sat on top of the desk. She brushed the thick layer of dust off them. The larger one was a plastic box with black glass on one side. In front of it lay a flat plastic rectangle with buttons. Each button had a letter on it, along with some other symbols she didn't recognize. As she moved around the room, her light dancing over more strange shapes, the headlamp's beam fell on a door. Another room? She rushed to the door. It had no theta wave receiver. She pushed against it, and it swung open, revealing another room beyond. This one held a number of large tables, each with its own sink. Posters hung on the walls. She studied each one, but she couldn't make sense of them. One showed a series of color-coded squares with letters and numbers in them. AG-47, HE-2, C-6. Most of the poster was ripped, decaying, pieces of it lying on the floor. Another showed a diagram of a circular object with smaller circles surrounding it. She couldn't believe it when her light fell on yet another door. The hole in the floor hadn't simply led to another room. This was vast. She was sure she was under one of the adjoining pods. The whole living unit building had been built on the ruins of some other structure. The place was ancient. Of that much she was sure. It smelled old, musty. She walked up to one of the large tables and wiped away dust. Glancing back at the mysterious posters, she walked across the room. A glass case on the far wall held small silver rocks. They weren't like the landscaping rocks outside of the living pod units. These were shiny, metallic-looking. She reached inside and picked one up, finding it unusually heavy. Uneasy, she slipped it inside her pocket. Even stranger shapes lay enshrouded in dust on a table along another wall. She brushed them off, finding equipment of some kind, but she had no idea what it was. She'd never seen anything like it. Bizarre tubes of glass and metal with knobs and dials. She wondered if they powered on, so she sent theta wave signals to them. They didn't respond. She touched the pieces, finding them clunky. She passed into the next room. Shivering in the damp, she noticed signs and drawings covering the walls. Another desk sat against the far wall, with the same ancient equipment sitting under a layer of dust, a tall black rectangle standing on its end, and a bigger rectangle on a stand of some sort. Shelves stood on either side of the old desk, filled with peculiar objects. She walked to one of the walls, her feet kicking up dust. She coughed. The signs on the wall were very thin, tacked there with rusted metal pins. She recognized letters on the page, but didn't understand most of the words. One sign focused on an image of a huge rock pocked with holes. She walked along the wall, taking in the images when she couldn't make out the words. The next showed a destroyed building with a massive pit next to it. An inset image showed another giant rock with a burned crust. The next few signs held images of fires consuming city blocks. She tried to read the writing beneath the images, but other than building, fire, and fell, she didn't understand them. She'd never seen so many different words in her life. Some of them were so long, an archaic form of English. Her written instructions always came to her in abbreviated format, like today. Corpse, cleanup, building, A, pod, 25. These words were long, clustered together in dense sections. Suddenly, the beeping noise returned, louder than ever. She was in the room with it. She snapped her head toward the ancient desk. A tiny red light glowed. Quickly, she moved to it, afraid someone above would hear her. The beeping came from one of two little boxes next to the bigger rectangles. She sent it a theta wave command to lower its volume, but nothing happened. Then she sent an off signal to no avail. Finally, she sought out the red light, finding a dial on one of the little boxes, which she tried to push but ultimately twisted. The beeping grew much quieter. Then with a click, it went away entirely. She turned it back on, leaving the volume very low. She felt along the bigger rectangle with the glass, finding a small button. She pushed it, and it began to glow beneath the dust. Wiping it off with her sleeve, she found a blank blue square staring back at her. It was a screen, she realized, an ancient one. It didn't hover in the air, but glowed outward from the sheet of glass, held within a plastic casing. She moved her hands over the upright rectangle next to it, feeling for another button. She found one and pushed it. Something hummed. Then the sound of a small fan filled the silence. In a few moments, the screen showed symbols. Circles. She couldn't believe the equipment could still be turned on. But she knew the whole building had been nuclear-powered for a long time. She didn't know for how long, only that the maintenance crew for the power plant had tales going back generations. This thing must still be plugged into that power source. The words "Sentry System" appeared at the top of the screen. Below them was a bright yellow circle. The third dot read "Earth." She'd heard an old man in the laundry facility once talk about how there were more planets than theirs, perhaps as many as 9. But this diagram showed smaller objects among the planets. 3 of them were flashing red and black, 2 small dots, followed by a very big one. As she stared at the moving diagram, the flashing triad moved ever closer to Earth, crossing into its orbit. The 3 smaller dots collided with Earth. A series of numbers flashed across the screen. Fragment 1, 3.7 kilometers, 0.00002 lunar distance, collision certain, Torino scale 9, regional damage. Fragment 2, 3.2 kilometers, 0.00031 lunar distance, collision certain, Torino scale 8, regional damage. Fragment 3, 942 meters. 0.00014 lunar distance. Collision certain. Torino scale 8. Regional damage. The animation continued. The big dot missed the Earth and continued its loop around the sun. It wheeled around, repeating its orbit. Once again, it entered Earth's trajectory, but this time they collided. A series of numbers read, main asteroid, 9.2 kilometers, 0.00011 lunar distance. Collision certain. Torino scale, 10. Global climatic catastrophe. The diagram changed now, zooming in to the little dot that was Earth. As the detail increased, drawn outlines appeared on the Earth, forming different shapes. She thought they might be the profiles of the lands. Then the animation showed exactly where the first two fragments would hit. A large portion of one of the landmasses bloomed red. Then she saw where the main object would strike on its next swing around the Earth. As it struck the planet, a red circle bloomed out from the area of impact. It swept outward, covering the entire Earth. She looked at the dates on the collisions. The first fragment was due to hit in 2 months. The main asteroid the next time it swung around the sun. She brushed off a lump in the dust, finding a plastic oval with two buttons. A wire ran out from it, plugging into the upright metal box. She clicked on one of the buttons, and the diagram with the circles vanished. The beeping stopped at once. She stared at a black screen with a blue icon that read, "Previous impact." When she moved the oval, an arrow moved on the screen. She clicked on the icon, and several small images appeared. She hovered over one of them and clicked the button again. Something new filled the screen. A movie. It was just like the videos she could create on her personal recording device, but instead of emanating on a floating display as it did on her PRD, it appeared on the glass screen itself. A woman was standing before a burning building, smoke billowing upward, the sky filled with black ash. The woman's voice came from the beeping device. "Since the catastrophic disaster on the mining asteroid Free Enterprise was first reported, we have been dreading this day. As underfunded government space agencies raced unsuccessfully to prevent the impacts, this nightmare has become a reality. Several fragments of the asteroid have landed here in Chicago, destroying a huge part of the downtown area. Residents have evacuated as more debris is expected to fall. Critics blame the current administration for not granting NASA enough funding to track near-Earth objects." H-124 could hear strange wailing noises in the background, mechanical and haunting. Flashing lights reflected off the building, and she could hear people screaming. "More fragments fell north of this location, causing a factory to catch fire and burn down several city blocks." The movie finished. She clicked the little button on the hand device, and the video played again. Now she clicked on a different image on the screen. Another movie opened. A man stood in front of more burning wreckage, the blackened shell of a building behind him. She heard his voice coming through and adjusted the small dial so it would be quieter. "The fourth of the huge fragments has devastated downtown Chicago," he said. "These are just small parts of the asteroid that have broken off after the catastrophic disaster on Free Enterprise. Scientists at NASA are now saying that the asteroid and its remaining fragments, far larger than the ones that have crashed here, have been knocked into an unknown orbit. NASA and the Jet Propulsion Lab will have to calculate their new trajectory before we know if these disastrous pieces of space rock will endanger our planet in the future. Though from what we've been told by our Washington, D.C. affiliate, while this has certainly been a devastating day for the city of Chicago, scientists have at least 80 years, possibly as long as 232, before the main asteroid and its larger fragments pass this close again." The movie stopped, and she watched it again, She didn't understand a lot of the words the man and the woman had said. Chicago? Asteroid? NASA? Washington? She clicked on the other image, and the animation opened again, showing the orbits of the planets and the flashing dots. She now knew what she was looking at. Those 80 years, or 232, had elapsed, and these things were coming fast. She whipped out her personal recording device. The room's technology was so old that she couldn't find a way to pair her PRD with the screen itself, so she had to settle for just using her camera. She filmed the animation, then the two movies. Plugged into the upright machine was a small metal and plastic device. It glowed along one side. She found several more in one of the drawers. On one end of each device was a shiny metal plug. She grabbed all of them and pulled the other one out of the machine. Something beeped when she did. In the drawers beneath the little devices was a small binder full of gleaming discs. She put that in her bag as well. She was just figuring out how to detach the machine itself when she heard shuffling on the floor above. She froze. She guessed that someone was coming down the hallway that led to the dead man's living pod. Only two people would use that hallway. Another cleaner? Or one of her employers? Maybe they were checking up on her progress. If they found her down here, she shuddered. She slung her bag over her shoulder and raced through the doorways back the way she'd come. Chapter 4. When H124 reached the rubble at the bottom of the hole, she stood, listening. All she could hear were the building's ventilation humming and the distant sounds from the neighbor's display. She climbed the pile of old rubble and peeked out into the man's living pod. She tensed, listening. Nothing unusual met her ears. The body still lay in the middle of the hallway, sealed inside the body bag. The smell of bleach hung heavily in the air. She didn't catch the sound of any more footsteps. Maybe they'd gone past this place, heading for a different living pod. She pulled herself out and quickly replaced the floorboards, slinging the carpet back in place. The foreign devices weighed heavily in her bag, even though she knew they were only a couple of ounces. She had to get out of there fast. She strapped the body bag to her harness and began dragging the man down the hall. She peered out through the hole in the wall. The neighbor still sat on his couch, display gleaming in front of him. He entered text in one small window, while watching a show about two girls shopping in a mega mall. He didn't turn as she hefted the body through the hole and hurried toward his front door. She started to close her eyes to use the theta wave receiver to open the door, but instead leaned forward, staring through the peephole. The hallway was clear. She sent the message to the TWR to unlock the door, and it hissed open. Glancing up and down the empty hall, she lugged the body out, dragging it along the floor. The incinerator stood at the end. She bent with the effort, clenching her teeth. Her mind sped along, wondering what to do. Her body was on autopilot, dragging the corpse toward the incinerator, the way she had countless times before in other living pods. The corridor lighting flickered overhead. If she told her employers about the asteroid, they'd know that she had been exploring, not just doing her job. She'd heard about other people who got distracted from their day-to-day tasks. Some were repurposed, moved into other, more menial positions. Others simply vanished. She knew she couldn't tell them. Even if they listened, could she trust them to go to public programming control? So they could broadcast the information? Her best bet was to go straight to the PPC herself. After she incinerated the body, she'd head to the media building, and her employers would be none the wiser. At the end of the hall, she stopped in front of the incinerator's TWR. She sent the thought for it to open, and a gleaming metal door slid open on the burner. An incinerator stood on every other floor of each residential building. It was easier that way. She unclipped the harness and stepped out of it. Unzipping the bag, she took one last look at the man and his head wound. Then she rolled him into the furnace and commanded the door to slide back, closing him inside. She sent the mental command to burn. She packed up the body bag, straps, and harness, returning them to her tool bag. At the exit door, she used the TWR to open it, and a gust of hot air swept over her from the outside. She didn't see the men until the outside door hissed closed behind her. Then she saw them, one at the end of the street, the other only a dozen feet away, staring at her. The closer one pulled out a gleaming metal tool and advanced. She recognized the black uniform, the armbands with the red insignia, the wide-brimmed hats worn low over their eyes. They were repurposers, and they'd come for her. Chapter 5. For a terrifying moment, H124 froze. The man with the gleaming tool met her eyes. His face was unnaturally pale, dark eyes glistening beneath a crop of short black hair. His black suit blended in with the shadows, and his face seemed to glow. The other repurposer moved behind him, two more joining them from the shadows. She stood at the top of the cement stairs, a metal railing at her back. The men advanced, and she forced her feet to move. Turning, she vaulted over the railing and landed hard on the asphalt beneath. She cracked her knee, but got to her feet quickly, taking off. Her tool bag slammed against her side. It was too heavy. She thought of ditching it, but she couldn't lose what she'd found. Ahead of her towered the other residential buildings of New Atlantic. Her ability to use the TWRs would get her into any of them, but she knew that the repurposers used them too. They'd be able to see that someone had passed through the door recently and could use it to track her. She wondered if they were tracking her even now through her PRD. She pulled it out of her pocket and switched it off. She had to think of something. Maybe find a door that didn't require a TWR to open. She knew that would be more likely in the older part of town, so she raced east. The city's floating light orbs provided scant illumination above her, casting everything in a sickly orange glow. Her boots pounded on the pavement, the noise alarmingly loud to her. They'd hear her. She chanced to look behind and saw the three running in the shadows, closing in. She darted down an alley between two of the residential skyscrapers, the stench of uncompacted trash assailing her senses. Normally, the trash dispensers came through and destroyed the garbage nightly, but they must not have come through yet. She leaped over the waste, smelling awful and excrement and blood. The end of the alley branched off into three separate passages. She shot left, trying to keep buildings between her and her pursuers. The bag slammed against her back as she ran. She wasn't going to make it if she didn't ditch it. She rounded a corner, then another, heading deep into the labyrinth of residential complexes. She turned every chance she got so she wouldn't be in the men's direct line of sight. Her lungs gulped for air. Why did they want her? What had she done wrong? Did they know she'd taken a break from her work and explored under the man's living pod? Her foot skidded on something slimy in the trash heaps, and she went down hard on her back. The bag swung to the side, the strap twisting on her neck. Up ahead, she saw an alcove in the wall, an old battered metal door without an electronic lock. She scrabbled to her feet and ran for it. She pushed its battered handbar, but it was locked. She ran ahead, pressed against the wall behind a mound of trash, and listened. The footsteps were close, but she gained ground on her pursuers. They must have taken a few wrong turns. She kept running,
turning left and right so many times she knew she'd have to use her PRD if she ever wanted to navigate back to her quarters. Then it hit her. She could never go back to her quarters. Her life as she'd known it was over. If these men caught her, she would never be the same again. She'd be one of those wiped automatons she'd seen in the underbelly of the warehouse she lived in. Button pushers. Vacant stares. Complacent. Unaware. Panic bloomed in her chest. And suddenly she didn't know where to go. She'd had nightmares like this before. Running and running from some terrible evil. Never able to gain enough ground. Never able to get away. She could hear the men's footfalls, closer now, and she turned down another alley. At the end, an old metal door stood open a crack. She raced to it, finding it rusted and loose on its hinges. She didn't know what lay beyond, but she had to stop, had to catch her breath and figure out where to go. She stepped into the shadows and quietly swung the door closed behind her. Her grasping hands found a deadbolt on the inside of the door, and she engaged it. As blackness took over her world, she ran her hands along rough brick. She had her headlamp, but she didn't dare switch it on. She didn't want the men to see the light under the door. Her groping hands found another door, but it was locked. She heard the men run by. They didn't try the door. Her chest heaved, her breath coming in ragged gasps. Her side burned with the effort of running. She slid her tool bag off her shoulder and felt around the contents. She tossed out as much as she could. Her cleaning supplies went first, followed by the body bag. She kept the rope, the harness, her headlamp, her multi-tool. She could feel the cold, round discs she'd found, along with the small plastic and metal devices. She zipped them up safely in an inner pocket. Now her bag weighed much less, so she slung it over her head, then tightened the strap securely against her. She listened, waiting for the men to come by again, terrified to hear the rattling of the doorknob as they tried it. But it didn't come. Her own body finally quieted, and her breathing eased. Her heart slowed. Then she heard something else. Someone was breathing, only feet away. She grabbed her headlamp and flicked it on. Crouching against the same wall she leaned against was a male, about her age. But she'd never seen anyone like him. He met her gaze, his blue eyes bright and sharp beneath a crop of short, spiky blonde hair. He hadn't shaved in a few days, as evidenced by the golden whiskers on his jawline. Colorful tattoos covered his tanned arms. She'd seen tattoos before, but they were always utilitarian, like marking the location of someone's living pod. But these were elaborate, decorative, beautiful. His clothes were ragged and artistic, sewn together from different pieces of cloth. He wore knee-high black boots over a ripped pair of red pants and a black tank top that clung to his muscular frame. She stared, not saying a word. He smiled. She heard distant footsteps, and he brought one finger to his lips in the universal symbol for quiet. He reached out and touched the lamp she was holding. She switched it off. She could feel his warm fingers touching hers. The men ran by. This time they did try the door, rattling the doorknob. But the deadbolt held, and they moved on. She heard one shout, "Split up!" And the footsteps faded away, heading off in different directions. When they were gone, she switched the light back on. He removed his hand, stood up, and slung a tattered gray canvas backpack over one shoulder. Cautiously, he went to the door. He opened it, glanced both ways,
then turned to her. She stared at him there in the doorway. His tanned face was not the lax, apathetic face of a citizen, and he had no head jack. He grinned at her once more and entered the alley, closing the door behind him. She was too scared to move. She switched off her light and huddled in the darkness. Before long, she realized he wasn't coming back. She switched the deadbolt back to its locked position and waited. Minutes dragged by. When a half hour had passed, she knew she'd eluded the men, at least for now. But she couldn't go home. She had no idea where to go. Where had that guy gone? What was he doing, hiding here? She thought of the discs in her bag, of what she'd learned in that forgotten building. She had to warn someone. When what felt like an hour had passed, she stood up, her legs aching from sitting tensely for so long. She unlatched the deadbolt and peered out. Beyond lay the city, and gleaming in the distance rose the tower, the spire that housed media operations. It was far. She didn't know exactly how far, but miles for certain. But if she could make it there, maybe someone would listen. They could call off the repurposers when they heard what she had to say. Surely this was more important than her taking a break from her duties. This was something that would change the face of the earth forever. Peering down the alley both ways, H124 emerged from her hiding place. She let the door close behind her and ran for the tower. Chapter 6. She darted down the alley, listening at each corner for sounds of the repurposers. It seemed she'd lost them, for now at least. She ran on, knowing it would take at least an hour to make it to the tower. The residential complexes stretched on and on. She'd never known there were so many. This was the longest she'd ever been outside, the farthest she'd ever traveled. She knew she was at least 2 miles away from her living quarters. The air hung like a wet weight, so heavy she sweated from every pore. Her shirt clung to her, and her feet swam in her work boots. Above the sky shield, the gray clouds of the night sky hung low, their undersides lighted by the orange wash of the city lights. The streets lay empty. She wasn't surprised. At this hour, only a corpse cleaner like herself would be out. The laundry, food, cleaning crews all would have finished by now. An electric buzz hung in the air, filling the silence. As she ran past the residential skyscrapers, she tried to count how many people must live in each, then how many buildings stretched to the horizon. Would anyone notice her? Help her? Every few blocks, she passed industrial complexes like the one she lived in, massive warehouses that contained the laundry, food-making, and baby facilities, as well as the living quarters of other workers. The dull throb of machinery thudded outward from these buildings, the ever-present, deafening cacophony of laboring equipment hidden away from the residential buildings, all that menial labor out of sight of the residents. She sped on, navigating by the landmark of the tower. She passed another industrial building. Light poured out from an open door, and she felt the blast of heat from clothes dryers working overtime just inside the entrance. Her body ached for a drink of water, but she forced herself onward. As she passed the mouth of an alley, she heard something move behind her. She staggered forward as someone struck her in the back of the head. Blistering pain erupted inside her skull, and she went down hard on one knee, collapsing on the hot asphalt. Hands grabbed her arms and pulled her down the alley. More hands grabbed her legs, and she felt herself propelled forward into the dark shadows of this stinking, trash-filled back street. Her head throbbed in pain as she fought, a grogginess that stole over her body. Her limbs felt like great manacles held them, and though she tried to thrash, her dull headache slowed her reflexes. "Place her down here," one of her captors said. She turned her head to see the same dark-haired repurposer she'd seen before. Sweat streamed down his face from under the brim of his hat, and his dark eyes glistened eagerly. He pulled out the gleaming tool, switching it on. The anticipation in his eyes chilled her. This was not just a job to him. He enjoyed this.
"Should we blast her first?"
another asked, reaching for his energy discharge weapon. "Then she wouldn't be awake," the dark-haired one said simply. He had the air of their commander.
"Hold her down."
Her head started to clear. She craned her neck around as they pinned her down on her stomach. Four men gathered around her, all dressed in the dark uniform of the repurposers, the efficient, tight-fitting suits, the shiny shoes. She kicked the one holding her legs square in the face. His nose erupted in a crimson spray, and he fell backward.
"What the hell are you doing?"
their commander barked to him.
"Get up!"
He struggled to grab her legs again as she tried to wrench free from the men holding her arms. Panic seized her as she felt the man grab her feet again.
"Sit on her," the commander shouted.
She felt a crushing weight as the man pinning her left arm sat down on her ribcage, forcing all the air out of her lungs. Now the leader came forward with the tool. He revved its tiny motor, and she heard the whir of the bone saw inside it. He was going to cut right through her skull. She thrashed her arms, flailed her legs, bucked her hips, and tossed her head around. As her head connected with the leader's hand, he almost lost hold of the tool. Cursing, he grabbed the back of her neck, forcing her face down hard against the asphalt. She fought with everything in her, hands thrashing against the pavement until they bled. She felt the cold metal of the tool connect with her scalp. A searing pain cut through her skin. Then a swift boot appeared, and the tool went flying. She heard a grunt. The leader flew backward, slamming against a brick wall. The weight off her back vanished, and she lifted her head as the repurposer slammed back against the wall. The man holding her legs cried out, and suddenly she was free. She punched the last man holding her right arm, sending him crashing onto his back. She was up, braced to fight. Standing in front of her, holding one of the men in a headlock, was the tattooed stranger. As the repurposer struggled in his grip, another came toward him. The stranger wrenched his elbow upward, cinching tighter around the man's neck. She heard the snap of bone, and the man slumped lifeless at the stranger's feet. Against the far wall, the leader leaped up. She faced him, expecting his men to jump her all at once. But the man on the opposite wall ran for the end of the alley, vaulting over a fence there. Another followed. The leader watched them go, eyes enraged, then turned to her. He brushed off his jacket and calmly bent down, picking up the shiny metal tool.
"I might have to do more than repurpose you," he said, walking toward her. "I might have to accidentally botch the operation."
Fear shot through her like an electric jolt. Her mouth went dry, her limbs heavy as cement bags. He didn't even acknowledge the outsider. The tattooed stranger stepped over the fallen repurposer and stood next to her. She could smell him when a gust of hot wind hit them, a curious mix of unidentifiable spices, sweat, and an earthy scent. The leader took in his fallen worker, then gazed slowly up at the blonde-haired stranger.
"I have no interest in you, wastrel. Go back to whatever sewer you crawled out of."
He advanced on H-124, but she fought the urge to bolt, knowing he'd only catch up to her again, bringing more reinforcements. But she'd never fought in her life before tonight. He came forward, and she stepped back, keeping a safe distance while she figured out what to do. The tattooed stranger did the same. Then hands grabbed her from behind. The two men had circled, not run away. The leader sneered.
One of the men grabbed the stranger, but he bucked him off, whirling around and kicking him in the face. H124 kicked out as the leader approached, landing a solid boot right to his knee. He went down hard, cursing. She thrashed, trying to throw off the man who held her arms. His fingers dug into her flesh as he held onto her relentlessly. The stranger's attacker had recovered, holding on to his ruined nose. Blood streamed through his fingers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.